Oh, wait, what? Excuse me? Oh, no, not right now. Well, why don't I take a message? Because you see, I've got an appointment for you for later. But now is not the time. Hello and welcome back to Ultra Human. I'm Rachel and I'm here to help you be your best human. So this week I finished a book called The Worry Trick by David Carnevale, and I'm going to be putting a link to The Worry Trick as well as his other workbooks on panic attacks and the fear of flight down in the description below. So just as a quick overall synopsis before I get into the one trick that he suggests that I just thought was kind of the most funny to envision, and it's the one that I'm definitely going to be putting into practice starting later today. The tagline to it is how our brain tricks us into expecting the worst and what we can do about it. So that's sort of the whole premise of the book, is that worry is this counterintuitive problem. It's the result of an ancient brain, literally our amygdala, looking for problems in our environment. And sometimes, when it's actually bored, maybe even at the best times in our lives, perhaps after something really good has happened, like we have more to lose, we've just had a child, or we have had a promotion at work, or our relationship is going really great, these might be the times when our fantastic brain gets into a rut where it starts looking for problems. And the what if factor really means let's pretend. And so it could be anything. It could be what if the roof collapsed? Well, what if the roof collapsed? You can't guarantee the roof isn't gonna collapse. You could call over some investigators and people like look to make sure you don't have termites and things like that. But no matter what, at the end of the day, you don't know that something can't happen. And that's really the point of a lot of the things that he gets at in this book. And I think just a generally good advice for ourselves is to realize that, like, you can't ever prove that something can't happen. So why don't you tell me in the comments below maybe like what your biggest worries are? Like, what are your biggest tripping out concerns that you know are not founded in any realistic possibility? But you just deal with maybe even on a daily basis. I know for me, that used to be my kids eating a poisonous mushroom, like constantly worried about that for no good reason, of the roof collapsing, and also like my car falling apart, like just catastrophic failure of like all the parts, like the wheels falling off and things like that. I just envisioned it happening every time I would get in the car for no good reason, and I'm very glad I'm mostly over these things, but I'm definitely excited to be implementing this whole worry appointment thing because I am gonna laugh my tush off. One of the things that I thought was very interesting is the way that he talked about the amygdala. So you may know that the amygdala is the sort of fight or flight, it's the response center of our brain that is in charge of a lot of. It's usually associated with negative emotions, but our amygdala is really great. We should really be very grateful for what our amygdala does for us. It has a one-way communication to the cerebral cortex. It does not take orders from anyone. It is the watchdog, the guard dog that is there to wake up when danger happens, do something about it, move you out of the way of that bus, make you react in the moment when necessary to keep you alive. So this amygdala is not very good at taking orders. It literally does not communicate in language. Its communication form is directly with the outside world. It is the first part of our brain that gets messages from the outside world. And so, a split second before you can consciously process something, the amygdala has already been made aware of what's happening in the environment. And so, when everything is good, the amygdala is basically inactive. It's still getting those signals because it has to be aware of when and if danger occurs. But it's not really taking in things and processing things. And that is why, if we have an irrational fear of dogs, where our neighbor's Chihuahua just causes us to go into a panic attack, we have this one-way communication happening between the amygdala and the cerebral cortex, where we can't reverse that communication and tell the amygdala with words, it's okay, this dog weighs as much as an apple, and I have nothing to worry about right now. And so, one of the things that this book gets into is that the only way to teach the amygdala what is and isn't okay and what is and isn't dangerous is to let yourself be exposed incrementally to the thing that you fear or worry about. And therefore, once that amygdala is activated, it becomes aware of the environment. And if you can use your conscious brain to suppress the impulses that the amygdala is putting out, like run, hide, fight, then you will teach the amygdala that actually everything in the environment right now is okay. I see that trigger thing, and I see that I'm physically okay, and I am sensing that my body is breathing at a normal rate. If you can get yourself to do that, all that much better, because your amygdala will pick up the physical sensations of the environment. It's not going to store or process you fighting back negative thoughts, however. And that's one of the big things that this book gets into, is that the counterintuitive problem means that the intuitive solution is usually the worst thing that we could do. So rather than trying to stop ourselves from thinking about bad or negative things, or even trying to rationalize with these negative thoughts, explaining to ourselves that the bad thing isn't going to happen, sometimes the best way to deal with these problems is, he calls it the rule of opposites. And so that brings us to the trick that we are going to discuss today as a means for dealing with worry. So this is called the worry appointment. So I know with myself and others that I have talked to about chronic worry, we tend to think that the best thing to do is try to ignore and suppress it, and just get through our day-to-day lives, and it just continues to kind of eat away at us in this subconscious way. It's literally like you have a bored puppy in your house that you're just trying to ignore, and the more you ignore it, the more bored that puppy gets, and it's going to eat your entire sofa before you get to it. So what's the best thing to do with a bored puppy? You get right in that little puppy's face and you start playing tug of war with it. Now, maybe it seems like you're encouraging bad behavior because the tug of war involves teeth and ripping and biting and growling and things like that. But actually, you're getting that puppy's energy out, and it's going to be a more well-behaved puppy when you're done with the tug of war. In that same way, when we schedule ourselves a worry appointment, it might seem like we're training our brain to worry. Don't worry about that. Your brain's already trained to worry. It's how we have survived for millennia. It's a lot better to worry about something that's not going to eat you than to get eaten by something that you didn't worry about. And that's why all of our brains are really kind of pre-programmed to have this worry problem. So during your worry appointment, you're gonna block yourself out 10 minutes. Try and do it at the best time of day for you. For me, that's gonna be right before I start making dinner. So kids are probably still busy, maybe taking a nap, maybe they're working on homework. I've got time where I can come up here either to my room or maybe lock myself in the bathroom with the fan on or something, because part of this is to look in the mirror and you take all your little notes of all your worries that you've thought of throughout the day, and you're gonna worry aloud to yourself for 10 minutes. Now, probably one of the first things that you will find is that you don't have 10 minutes worth of new shit to worry about. So you're probably going to be standing there for a couple of minutes reciting off these worries before you start to feel really silly, because you're just repeating yourself now. How many times can I say into this mirror in the course of 10 minutes that the roof is going to fall down and, like, you know, ponder about what it's like to be squashed like a bug and stuff like that before it starts to just feel silly? And that's kind of the point, that incremental exposure, you're activating your amygdala, you're raising all of these like physiological heightened responses, and then you're spending time there in that space with those thoughts, and you're really ruminating on them. So rather than fighting them and trying to push them away, which your amygdala does not process as far as the rationalization goes. It just still feels the physical sensation of fear, flight, suppression, and you just continue to compound this problem because it's also drawing in all of the association from the rest of your environment as new things to worry about or associate with that trigger. So the funniest part about this that I can think of is that whole seeing yourself there in the mirror and repeating these worries, it very quickly is going to associate in a way that your amygdala can process because you're getting visual feedback that these worrisome thoughts are associated with a sense of humor because you're literally there standing looking at yourself saying these things. Eventually, you are going to crack a smile. Maybe if you're having a hard time with that, try and turn some of these worries like into a little song. He suggests making songs or poems out of them because even if you just take exactly what your normal concern is, but you turn it into a song, you're turning it into something else. You're communicating. He even suggests if you know a second language or even like just enough of a second language, or even if you don't, just like translating your worry into pig Latin while you are repeating this to yourself, because you've got 10 minutes and about 2 minutes worth of worries. And so in that time, if you take the time to kind of like switch up the way that you communicate this thing to yourself, you are going to start laughing at some point. And while that amygdala is activated, you are training it that these things are nothing to be that concerned about. So thank you for your time. I really hope that this did something for you. I will be revisiting the worry trick and some more of the little tricks and tips that are in there. I hope that this has helped you get out there and be your best human.